Watch this video till the end to know the most important must-know dermatology topics for NEETPG 2025. Hello dear students, myself Dr. Maddineni Srinivas, welcome to Crack Dermatology DrMSD. So let us begin our discussion with the basics. Stratum Lucidum, it is an extra epidermal layer which is present in the palms and soles. It is present between, I hope you remember the mnemonic, come let's get sunburned. So it is present between the stratum corneum and the stratum granulosum. And remember, stratum spinosum is going to have antigen presenting cells which is called as the Langerhans cells. And coming to the primary skin lesions, remember macules, papules and purpura, all of them are primary skin lesions. Macules and patches, you remember them in combination, they are flat lesions which are neither raised nor depressed. Less than 1 centimeter is macule and more than 1 centimeter is a patch. So basically they can be hyperpigmented or hypo or depigmented. Coming to the papular lesions, so these are elevated circumscribed solid raised lesions which are less than 1 centimeter in size. If they are more than 1 centimeter, we are going to call them as plaques, and if there is a depth component, we call it as a nodule. So petechia purpura ecchymosis, it is basically extravasation of the red blood cells. I hope you remember this. Isotretinoin, which is a oral retinoid, is used in the treatment of the acne, grade 4 nodular cystic acne, which is a severe form of acne vulgaris. This is also called as 13-cis retinoic acid, and it can cause teratogenicity, embryopathy. That's the reason why it is avoided in a pregnant woman or in any individual who is a reproductive age group female. And if there is a requirement of a pregnancy in the individual who took the isotretinoin, there should be a washout period of at least 1 month or 3 months. Remember this very important point. It's also called as 13-cis retinoic acid. Related to psoriasis vulgaris, remember it's also called as chronic plaque psoriasis, most common type of psoriasis, which will present with silvery white scaly plaques present over the extensor surfaces. And whenever there is a scaly lesion, we take a glass lid and we'll try to scrape the scales. And this scraping is called as grattage test. And finally, we are going to get a membrane called bulbous membrane. If you even remove that, we get pinpoint bleeding spots, which is the end point of the auspice sign, which is pathognomonic for psoriasis vulgaris. Remember, in the nails, the most common nail finding is the pitting or depressions of the nail plate. The pathognomonic sign is called as oil drop sign, or it is also called as salmon patch, which clinically is going to appear like this yellow oil drop like appearance. And this is what is called as Koebner's isomorphic phenomenon, which is the development of morphologically similar looking lesions away from actual site of the lesions due to the underlying autoimmunity. And which conditions will show this? Koebner's positivity, psoriasis, lichen planus and vitiligo. I hope you remember this mnemonic, PSLV. Okay, so next is the pemphigus vulgaris. Remember, this is an intra-epidermal blistering disorder. So the blisters are going to have flaccid roof. And if you do a biopsy, we can see the suprabasal split and an important finding called as row of tombstone appearance, because the stratum basal cells are still attached to the underlying dermoepidermal junction with the help of the hemidesmosomes. Remember, in these, the patients are going to have autoantibodies against the desmoglein 3 more than desmoglein 1. So that is the reason why the keratinocytes will lose the attachment between themselves, but the stratum basal cells are attached to the underlying dermoepidermal junction with the help of hemidesmosomes, which are still intact, giving rise to this row of tombstone appearance. Very important. And we can also see the presence of these acantholytic cells, not only in the zinc but also in the biopsy. We can see, what are these? These are basically the keratinocytes which are separated from one another, and now they are round cells which are having a perinuclear halo and they are having a central hyperchromatic nucleus. So these are all important points related to acantholytic cells. And remember, if you do a direct corneal fluorescence, which is the investigation of choice, we are going to see the deposition of IgG and C3, giving rise to the fishnet or chicken wire pattern, as you are able to see here. Very important, pemphigus vulgaris, mucosal lesions will be present, whereas in pemphigus foliaceous, mucosa will be spared because desmoglein 3 is not having any antibodies in pemphigus foliaceous. Next condition is erythrasma, which is produced by Corynebacterium minutissimum. Under the Wood's lamp examination, we are going to see the presence of the coral red fluorescence because of the coproporphyrin 3 produced by the Corynebacterium minutissimum. Very important point. Related to P. versicolor, it is a superficial fungal infection due to the Malassezia globosa and Malassezia furfur. And to diagnose this, potassium hydroxide mount is utilized, in which we are going to see a combination of the spores and the hyphae, which is giving rise to the appearance which is called as spaghetti and meatball appearance. Spaghetti meatball appearance. Fixed drug eruption, remember the patients are going to have a history of some medication usage, NSAIDs, metronidazole, sulfonamides, followed by which there will be development of a dusky red hue initially when the disease is active, and finally the lesion is going to heal with a very bad pigmentation, and this is going to have a history of recurrence at the same site when the patient takes the same drug, fixed drug. That's why it's called as fixed drug eruption. Tinea capitis, when a child is presenting with scaly hair loss, always think of tinea capitis. If the lesion clinical looks like a black dot, then think of the endothrix, where the organism is trichophyton tonsillans in violation. And if there is a gray scaly patch of tinea capitis, think of the ectothrix, which is due to the microsporum canis, which can also show the green fluorescence on the Wood's lamp examination. Coming to the leprosy, remember we have Ridley Joplin classification into tuberculoid leprosy and lepromatous leprosy. In between we have the BT, BB and BL type of leprosy. So if you do a lepromin test, it is going to give us the prognosis of the leprosy, not the diagnosis. So in tuberculoid leprosy, patients are having good immunity, so lepromin test will be positive, whereas in lepromatous leprosy, the immunity is very poor, so there will be more acid fast bacilli, so lepromin test will be negative. And clinically, few hypopigmented anesthetic patches will be seen in the tuberculoid pole, whereas in the lepromatous leprosy, patient's face is going to look like a lion. What is the reason? Because of the multiple nodules, skin color nodules present over the face, leonine facies. And remember, we have the lepra reactions, type 1 and type 2 lepra reactions. Both of them are treated with the steroids, and the MDT, multi-drug therapy, is going to be continued. It should not be stopped. Now the MDT is going to be the same for posibacillary as well as multibacillary patients, with the three medications, rifampicin, dapsone, clofazamine, and dosages are here. The only difference is the duration is going to be 6 months in PB and 8-12 months in the multibacillary patients. Coming to this question, many students are having a doubt related to this. So trophic ulcer, when it develops in a patient of leprosy, if the wound is clean without any pus, without any pain, then what is a simple treatment we are going to use? In that, we are going to use the management of bed rest and the application of the cast. But if the patient is having a dirty wound which is painful or symptomatic, then it might be infected. So that's the reason why we have to debride and do the dressing, proper dressing for this patient. So this is the difference between these two questions. Now related to the nerves, remember ulnar nerve is the most common peripheral nerve involved in the leprosy, and if a patient of leprosy has a lesion over the face, then think of the most common cranial nerve, which is going to be involved as facial nerve. Okay, next is dapsone is the drug of choice for dermatitis herpetiformis and also chronic bullous disease of the childhood, which is also called as linear IgA bullous dermatosis. So remember, dear students, in dermatitis herpetiformis, patients are going to present with very, very itchy papulovesicular lesions present on the extensor surfaces. And if you do a biopsy, we are going to see the presence of neutrophilic microabscess in the dermal papilla. And if you do a direct immunofluorescence, we are going to see the deposition of IgA in a granular fashion. So it will be IgA in a granular fashion in dermatitis herpetiformis, and it is associated with a gluten sensitive enteropathy or celiac disease. The next condition, CBDC, clinically is going to present as the annular lesions, which are going to be studded with vesicles and bullous lesions, giving rise to this cluster of jewels or crown of jewels appearance. And if you do a immunofluorescence, we are going to see the deposition of IgA in a linear fashion along the dermoepidermal junction or basement membrane zone. Finally, sexually transmitted disorders. If the patient is presenting with a genital ulcer, if there are multiple painful genital ulcers, two possibilities, one is chancroid and the other one is herpes genitalis. So if the examiner mentions that the patient is having an inguinal lymphadenopathy which is having a pus collection, that is bubo, then think of the diagnosis as a chancroid. But if the examiner mentioned that there is bilateral inguinal lymphadenopathy but bubo is absent, then think of the diagnosis of herpes genitalis, which is usually produced by herpes simplex virus 2 more than 1. Coming to this side, single painless genital ulcer and there is no inguinal lymphadenopathy, what is the diagnosis? It is donovanosis, which will have pseudo bubo instead of the actual lymphadenopathy. It is also called as granuloma inguinal. The causative organism is Klebsiella granulomatis or Kallimatobacterium granulomatis. If the patient is having a painless inguinal lymphadenopathy, then the diagnosis is going to be syphilis. I hope remember this syphilis, because both genital ulcer as well as lymphadenopathy are painless. If the examiner mentions the presence of the bubo, which is very painful in a patient having single painless genital ulcer, then the diagnosis is going to be lymphogranulomavinorum, which is produced by chlamydia trachomatis L1, L2 and L3. So this is all about the important points related to dermatology. I hope it was helpful. If so, please do the like button, and if you are not yet subscribed to my channel, please do subscribe for more such dermatology related awesome content on a regular basis. And see you soon in the recall of the NEETPG dermatology session. All the very best, dear students. You have done the great work. You are going to get great results. Believe in yourself. You are going to do great. Sarvam Sri Krishna Arpanam Sarvejana Sukhina Bhavantu.